Very good.
So want to welcome everyone again to Environmental Fridays. It is personal. This is another very special episode, and you will hear some more about it here pretty soon. To learn more information about Environmental Fridays, you can go to our website at www.theenvironmentalfridays.com. For the month of April, we begin with the three T's, Tomlin, Teteh, Turner. How does beauty and personal products affect your health? And so, this is where we begin this month of April. Then next week, we will look at incorporating environmental science in Trinidad and Tobago. So we go back to Trinidad and Tobago at the high school level. Then on the 21st, we go to New Mexico and look at some of the issues there involved in sawmill cleanup in Red Lake, New Mexico. And finally, for the month of April, we will hear from Susan Buchanan, Princella Tobias, about a campaign, a program that actually got started as a result of Environmental Fridays. It is called A is for Asthma. And that's sort of like a report in a way of what we've been doing in terms of asthma education and information and meeting and working with the community regarding the asthma challenges. So that's what's coming up for this month of April. My co-host today, Gloria Brown Wright, is a retired professor of chemistry at Central Connecticut State University. She received her PhD in chemistry at University of Texas, Austin, a master's in physical chemistry at Ohio State University. She is an alumni. What year did you graduate from Andrews, if you don't mind telling us?
1970.
Okay, sounds good. And she did a one-year study at Seminaire. I don't know how to pronounce that French word.
Seminaire Adventiste du Salève.
There you go. And did a one-year student missionary, was a one-year student missionary to Indonesia. She is from Jamaica. What part of Jamaica?
That's always a challenge. I always say mostly in the West.
Mostly in the West.
Because I've lived so many places.
Okay.
But the last place was in Mandeville when I taught at Westerners College, now Northern Caribbean University.
Right. NCU. And so you took your A-levels at a government school or?
Yes.
Okay. So the A-levels, for those of you who may not know, Americans, it's I guess British system that we've replaced with a Caribbean-based exam. And it serves more as an entry into university or to work.
Yeah, it actually, because of that, I didn't have to do general chemistry in college.
Me too. I went directly into organic. So Gloria, it's good to have you as a co-host today. And I would begin with introducing our first speaker and you will follow up with our second. And we'll do the introductions right now at the top. So our first speaker today is Ms. Tiah Tomlin-Harris. She's a overcomer. We always love overcomers of triple negative breast cancer, as she called it, has dedicated herself to being a community change agent and advocate with a focus on health disparities, Black women's health and healthy lifestyle education. She has received recognition and awards, including President Bush's Points of Light. So this is the former Bush, right? The older Bush that passed away. Yeah, Points of Light. After diagnosis with breast cancer at a young age, she believed that no one should walk this journey alone and founded the My Breast Years Ahead Sisterhood. When was that founded?
That was founded in 2016.
2016, okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, and then co-founded My Style Matters, which is a 501c grassroots nonprofit organization dedicated to educating and supporting underserved families impacted by cancer. And throughout her life's work, Tia is moving people from awareness to action. And that basically is what we try to do on Environmental Fridays, not just talk about it, not just educate, but also be proactive and active in these areas. So thank you, Tia, for accepting our invite. Gloria, you could now introduce our other two speakers.
Yes, our second speaker, Mr. D. Bing Turner, was born in Compton, California, and also raised there. I'm sorry. Let me get rid of this. Oh, my daughter is calling me, and oh. Okay. I'm so sorry. Yes, as I was saying, and I can't turn it off because I'm using my phone to read this. Yes, Mr. Turner graduated from the prestigious King Drew Medical Magnet High School, and then he went on to Morehouse College, where he did a degree in education and then a master's of public health from Claremont Graduate University. He's a community-grounded public health professional who courageously seeks opportunities to create systems, models, and programs that can provide access for those who have been disengaged or who have been misrepresented. He views public health as a dynamic discipline and active concept that can be used to empower communities and to create change for a healthier perspective and healthier local environment. He's the co-founder of Heritage Farmers Market and the Heritage Wellness Collective. And then our third speaker will be Assistant Professor Dede Teteh, and she has promised to correct my pronunciation later. And she's a certified health education professional with a wide breadth of experience across academia, research, policy development, and strategic communications. She brings a deep knowledge of the public health sector, spanning both individual and community health, as well as a teaching and research-based background. Through her work in community advocacy and prevention, as well as several roles at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, she has cultivated an interest in sustainable public health infrastructure and building healthier communities, particularly in Black populations. As a social behavior scientist, Dr. Teteh uses community-based participatory research approaches to reduce health disparities and promote health equity in African diaspora populations. Dr. Teteh was born and raised in Lomé, Togo, and grew up in Bronx, New York, Atlanta, Georgia, but currently calls Southern California her home, where she is an assistant professor at Chapman University.
Very good.
And so we will give our attention to our three speakers.
All right, very good. So Tia, you could go ahead and upload your Yes.
Awesome. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Thank you so much for joining, and thank you so much for having me. My name is Tiah Tomlin-Harris, and today, just for a short second, I'm going to be talking to you about taking action with your breast health. And this is really important, because 1 in 8 women in the US will be diagnosed with cancer, breast cancer, in their lifetime. And every 2 minutes, a woman is diagnosed, and every 13 minutes, a woman dies from this disease. Well, we tend to think about this disease as a woman's disease. And in actuality, it's a people's disease because men can get breast cancer too. As a matter of fact, 1 in 833 men will be diagnosed with this disease in their lifetime. But we think about breast cancer not only when it comes to adults, we forget to think about those who are young. And we call this group of people from ages 15 to 39 the AYA, or adolescent and young adult community. And they actually will be diagnosed with breast cancer too. And as a matter of fact, about 5.6% of those who have been diagnosed with breast cancer are actually within this age range. So this is a very critical topic. And as I stated, it is a people's disease and not just a woman's disease. But breast cancer, it hits some groups different. For Black women are 3 times more likely to be diagnosed with an aggressive form of breast cancer called triple negative. They're more likely to be diagnosed with cancer that has spread to the lymph nodes or later stages. Under the ages of 35, Black women are 2 times more likely to be diagnosed and 3 times more likely to die. And we're more likely to have the cancer to recur. As a matter of fact, it's 39% more likely for the cancer to come back. When we look at the disparity rate across the US, Black women are 40% more likely to die from breast cancer. And breast cancer is now the leading cause of cancer-related death in Black women. So this is a health crisis. Unfortunately, I became a statistic when I was young. I was, of course, female, Black, young. I was under the age of 40, so I was considered to be an AYA. And I actually found the lump myself. And lastly, I was diagnosed with an aggressive form of breast cancer and had a recurrence of breast cancer. So I'm here to have the conversation with you about breast health and how it's so important. But when you think about breast cancer, sometimes we ask the question, exactly what is breast cancer? Well, when we look at normal cell development in our bodies, normal cells typically grow, they divide, and they know when to stop growing and they die off. But with cancer, there's typically what happens is the DNA within those cells, they get damaged, and we call that mutations. And they get mutated for so many reasons, which we're going to be talking about some of those today. But too many of these mutations can cause these cancer cells or these cells to grow and divide out of control, which will then lead to what we know as cancer. Now, with breast cancer, many of us know that, hey, it's breast cancer, but there are actually different types of breast cancer. I'm not expecting you to remember all of these, but just understand some of the breast cancers are driven by hormones and some are not driven by hormones. And the one that I mentioned before that's an aggressive form is triple negative. And that particular breast cancer or subtype of breast cancer is not driven by hormones. We're going to talk more today, as you hear Dr. Dede and Bing speak. They're going to talk about how these hormones kind of play a role in the beauty products that we're using. Now, when we think about breast cancer, it does happen in stages, and we always hear the words early detection. And it's because we want to be able to detect it early. The sooner we can detect it, the better the treatment outcomes are. And not only the treatment outcomes, but also the survival rates. As you can see here, if we find it early, we're 99% more likely to have better outcomes. But if it's regional, meaning it's starting to spread beyond the breast, it's 86%. And if it's metastatic or distant, where it's now spread to our organs, again, it's 30% survival rate. So we want to be able to detect it early. And when we talk about metastatic disease, getting back to those disparities, unfortunately, 1 in 3 of those who are considered early stagers will later in life develop metastatic disease. For Black women, we're 61% more likely to develop metastatic breast cancer. And de novo means the first time that a person is diagnosed with breast cancer, Black women are 5% more likely to be diagnosed de novo with stage 4 breast cancer. And Black women have a 58% higher rate than white women to be diagnosed with metastatic disease. So the conversation that we're having today is extremely important. As I stated before, it is a health crisis. But screening, we must get screened. This is how we go about detecting breast cancer. Now, first and foremost, we are our own mechanism of defense. We should be aware of our breasts. We should know what they look like, what they feel like. And men, you should know what your chest look like and what it feels like. We should also be having conversations with our doctors about clinical breast exams or clinical chest exams if you're at high risk. And this is where the doctor is going to look and feel for any abnormalities in your breast and or your chest. Now, these are not considered screening, but these are mechanisms for you to help detect breast cancer. Screening is what we call mammograms. And we typically start if we're not at high risk, meaning we don't have a family history or any kind of genetic mutation, we will start mammograms at the age of 40. So 40 to 44, we can have the conversations with our doctors about getting screened. When we're at 45 to 54, we should definitely be getting mammograms. The ages of 55 to 74, you can start having conversations with your healthcare provider whether or not you should be getting mammograms every single year or whether you should go every other year. And if you're over the age of 75, it's not really recommended because they don't see any kind of survival benefit. Now, if you are high risk, again, if you have a family history or any kind of genetic disposition, when it comes to breast cancer, you can start getting screened a little bit earlier. Typically, they would start the screening at age 30. And what they will do is they will do additional testing. In addition to a mammogram, they will also do a MRI. Now, if there are other discoveries within the breast, they will then do additional testing. It may be an ultrasound, it may be a biopsy, or it may be a PET scan. Now, what's really important, go back to the self-breast exams. 40% of the women who were diagnosed over the age of 40 actually discovered the lump in their breast. But when we look at those who are young, 80% of those who are 15 to ages 39 actually found the lump themselves. So the first level of defense is you getting to know your breast and or your chest. And we always tend to think about lumps when it comes to breast cancer, but there are other things that can be a good indication that it could potentially be breast cancer. Things like redness, darkening, swelling or thickening in your breasts, any kind of sores or rashes, if there's persistent warmth in your breast, a change in the shape or the size of the breast, if it looks like an orange peel where it's very porous, if there's dimpling or puckering, or you may have pain or itching in one spot that's persistent, you could have sores or a rash on the nipple, you could have nipple discharge or even a change in your vein pattern. So these are things we really want to look at. And this is why it's important not only to feel, but also to look at our breast. And when we think about our breast tissue, we also want to be mindful that our breast tissue is not just the rounded part of the breast, but it's also tissue up into the clavicle, down your sternum or under your rib cage, under the breast, and even under the arm. All of that tissue is our breast tissue. So we should be checking, looking, and doing physical checks when it comes to our breast. Now, oftentimes we hear, you know, I get asked the question, where does breast cancer come from? And it's a multifactorial disease. It's not just one thing, it's several factors. And it's a complex disease. But what we do know is that there are three areas where breast cancer can be triggered: genetics, environmental, and lifestyle. So quickly, I'll go through genetics. 5 to 10% of women who have been diagnosed with breast cancer actually have a genetic mutation. This is something that's inherited from a parent or family member. And there are different types of genes that they look for when they do genetic testing. The BRCA gene, 1 or 2, or you may hear people call it BRCA gene, they're more likely to be found in Black women and Ashkenazi Jewish women. And that puts us at a higher risk for breast cancer. There's also the PALB2 gene, as well as the abnormal check gene. And there are other genes that they're doing research on to identify whether or not those also can be indicators whether or not you have a genetic mutation. And what that means, if you do have a genetic mutation, doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be diagnosed with breast cancer. It just means that you're 80% more likely to be diagnosed with breast cancer. And so when we think about our family, we really want to know our family health history. It's critical. whether it's a mother, a daughter, an auntie, an uncle, a grandparent, a father, a brother, cousins, we really want to know in our family if there's any history of cancer. If we have one first degree female relative, our risk is doubled. If we have two first degree female relatives, our risk is five times higher. And of course, if a father or brother has been diagnosed with this disease, it increases your risk, as well as other relatable cancers such as colorectal, ovarian, or prostate. So again, it's in the genes, and know your family health history. Another area is lifestyle factors. As a matter of fact, according to the American Cancer Society, they've indicated that 42% of cancer cases and 45% of cancer-related deaths in the United States are really linked to modifiable risks and thus could be prevented. So we're going to be talking about those things as you hear Bing, as well as Dr. Dede, talk about beauty products and how it's impacting our health. Now, I talked about some things that are out of our control, but these are some things that are within our control. The things that we're putting in our body, our weight, because the more fat we have on our body, it feeds into the estrogen. Exercising, it's so critical and so important to move our bodies, help get that lymphatic system moving, to reduce some of those toxins and things that we're being exposed to. Our stress level, it indirectly causes things to happen to our body, which then can lead to a diagnosis of breast cancer. Rest, it's important that we're getting enough rest. The World Health Organization is actually looking at night shift and saying people who work at night, that could be a potential carcinogen because our body is not getting enough of the melatonin that we need to help ward off cancer when we don't get enough rest at night. Smoking, alcohol, those also are good contributors to a diagnosis of breast cancer. And low levels of vitamin D. There's a correlation between breast cancer and low levels of vitamin D. And then there's that big old word, T, the toxins. Again, we're going to be talking about some of those things that are in the products, skincare products, hair care products that we use on a regular basis that put us at a greater risk for breast cancer. And then lastly, environmental factors. So these are some of the things that we see that are in our foods, water, body fat, chronic stress, gut health, birth control pills, early onset puberty, late age pregnancy, late age menopause, personal care items, heavy metals, and our plastics, car exhaust, pesticides, cleaning solutions, fragrance, pollution, and there's so much more. These have synthetic chemicals in them that act like estrogen in our bodies and can put us at a greater risk for breast cancer. So the biggest question that we're asking today is, are you feeding it or are you fighting it? What are the things that you're doing each and every day that can either contribute to a diagnosis of breast cancer or can fight breast cancer? Thank you so much for your time, and I'm going to turn it over to Bing.
All right. Thank you, Tia. We'll ask questions, I guess, at the end.
Yes. If people want to ask questions verbally or if they want to write, I mean, orally or write in the chat.
Yes. All right.
So, good morning, everybody. So just to sort of give you guys context, to give everyone context as to how we actually began this research. It's hard to believe it was 10 years ago, since 2013. Research actually started as a project at Loma Linda University, and it's in Southern California. And the most interesting thing about this project was that if you look at the picture, the first two African-American women, these were women that were actually based in the community. The first young lady, Phyllis Clark, she operates a nonprofit called Healthy Heritage. The second young lady next to her is Eudora Mitchell. She worked the community outreach program of Quinn Community AME. So these were two community members. And what happened, there was rumblings in the community about the idea of, you know, hair care products being linked to breast cancer. One of the nearest research institutions, the most respected research institutions in the community at the time is Loma Linda University. So the third woman in the picture That's Dr. Susan Montgomery. And Dr. Susan Montgomery was really known in the community for doing community-based participatory research. At the time, community-based participatory research, CBPR, was sort of, it was cutting edge, it was new, it was novel. There was language given to the actual idea of community members working with researchers to actually do research in the community. And so these two African-American women went to this researcher and say, hey, this is what's being discussed in the community. Is there an opportunity to do research? And she said, yes. My role in this project, there's a picture of me on one end and there's a picture of Dede Teteh on the other end. I was a research analyst on the academic end. Ironically, Dr. Teteh was a research assistant and a doctoral student on the community end. And so we sort of came together and we sort of had sort of these discussions over a period of a couple of months. We found some research funding. It was funded by the California Breast Cancer Research Program. And so we began doing the work of actually asking questions about this linkage between breast cancer and chemicals and hair care products. Over the span of 18 months, we'll go back to the other slide. Over the span of 18 months, we were able to do surveys. We were able to do community-based key informant interviews. We did focus groups. We were able to survey over 400 people in this study. Interesting, there was a component where we actually looked at men that was part of this study. So we talked to men about their concepts and ideas about breast cancer, hair care products. We wanted to know what they knew and felt and what they had been hearing about, you know, their partners and their mothers and their sisters about this issue. Next slide. So at the end of the project, after 18 months of doing all this exhaustive work, these were sort of the main findings. And actually some cool things were developed through this research project. So we found out that the hair was synonymous with identity. We also found out that there was a lack of education of stylists. There was a lack of education for stylists knowing about how to disseminate this information about breast cancer, about the chemicals that are found inside these products. And we were trying to find ways of actually how to translate the research to get this information through social media, communal spaces, salons, churches. One of the cool things, like I said earlier, that we found, or that was created, we developed the validated Black identity hair product use in breast cancer scale. So that was actually created out of this 18-month research project. We also knew, like I said earlier, that there was a lack of knowledge of endocrine disruptive chemicals, products, ingredients, and detrimental health risks. So one of the things that we did in the project, I mean, we simply had a list that we got from hairstylists, from beauticians in the community. They submitted the list to our scientific researchers that were on the project. We compiled the list and we sent the list to a lab. And we actually sent the products to the lab and they tested all these chemicals. And I'll let Dr. Teteh tell us what the end result of that. And then some of the things that we also found out, that everything causes cancer, so why change? And I think that speaks more so to what we found was that everything in the chemicals actually could be cancer causing, but it's not a direct correlation or connection to breast cancer per se. And then also, as the previous presenter presented, that a lot of things are environmental. So what we drink, the lack of exercise, what we eat, what we put into our bodies has impact on our health and well-being. Next slide. So the baton was passed. After the project ended 18 months, we did our final report. The baton was passed from the community organization and Dr. Montgomery at Loma Linda University. And then Dr. Teteh took over the project with funding with her partner, Dr. Trevino. This was between 2019 and 2022. The perspective that they approached this research was, they looked at community folks, survivors, bench scientists, tribologists, stylists, and public health specialists, and we used artists. And again, we looked at community voices. So we actually had over 600 participants, and a little under half of the participants were breast cancer survivors. And this project was funded by the American Cancer Society, private donations, and also a lot of institutional support. Next slide. And so as this project has moved forth, we sort of have this partnership. We have this initiative where we're continually doing this work and presenting at conferences and workshops. It's a partnership between Bench to Community and Heritage Farmers Market and Heritage Wellness Collective and My Style Matters, Inc. Thank you.
All right, very good. And then Dr. Teteh.
Hi, everybody. Happy Sabbath to those that are observing. Yeah. In a few hours. So thank you again so much for having us. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. I'm going to be the last speaker, bringing it all together. So let's bear with me as I do that. And sorry, Bing, that was supposed to be trichologist. Like, what's a tribologist?
I learned something new in real time.
You went with the audience. Go ahead. So trichologists are individuals that deal with specifically the scalp. And we have a community advisory board member, Tanya Fairley, as a part of the Bench to Community Initiative, and that's one of her specialties. So more than happy to give you all some information about that for those that are interested. So again, hello, everybody. My name is Dede Teteh. I am, as previously stated, an assistant professor of public health at Chapman University here in Orange, California. So I have the distinct honor of serving in the space with the wonderful folks from my community, both in Atlanta, as well as here in Southern California with Tiah and Bing, being a member of our community advisory board for the Bench to Community Initiative. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Sound coming good? Okay, perfect. Mm-hmm. So Tia really introduced the why and the who. Bing provided context about how we are doing this work around personal care products and breast cancer risk via the Bench to Community Initiative. Again, the baton has been passed. So those are my mentors from the Cost of Beauty Project, and that really set the stage throughout my doctoral studies, as well as my postdoc training, and now as a tenure track assistant professor. So this is the beauty of community-based participatory research. I love this space because so many people are able to be a part of the conversation and provide their voices, and hopefully everybody benefits at the end. So I'm a product of actually using this methodology for training and building a research career out of it as well. So I'm going to round out this conversation with providing some sociocultural impact of beauty and breast cancer risk. So we learned a lot from the Cost of Beauty Project, and really this is an example of the conversations that we've heard, and I'm utilizing these particular slides to animate the conversation even further and introduce the topic. So let's get started.
A little girl with a pressing curve. Don't touch my hair. When it's the feelings I wear. Don't touch my soul. I wear my hair.
All right, so if you recognize those particular tunes and sounds, you can let me know in the chat. Let's see if you remember some of these. So India Ari declares to us that she is not her hair, but the soul that lives within. We have Solange that proclaims touching of her hair and many of our own is dangerous territory. And at some point, Willow Smith just urges us to just whip our hair back and forth because sometimes that's what she got to do. So what's hair got to do with this conversation? So we learned a little bit about some aspects of that. So I'm going to bring that into this conversation before we talk about our products. So when you ask Black women what hair has to do with anything, they'll say everything. Some of us will say everything. We asked a number of Black women this question, as well as Black men. And this is just a quote from one of our participants who is a stylist here in Southern California. It, meaning hair, has to do with everything. It has a lot to do with your health. It's very important. It's almost scary how important it is. Even in the context of our personal relationships with our hair, we also have to acknowledge the politics of hair in our society that really upholds Eurocentric ideals of beauty. It's the gold standard, but not for all of us. And the women and also the men that were a part of our research really shared a lot of that, the realities of this discourse with us. And this is just a quote to really bring some of that context forward. So if the majority of commercials and ads that we saw looked like Lupita from 12 Years a Slave, well, everything will be flipped on its head. And I'll let you digest the rest of the quote here on the screen from one of our Black male participants. So if we focus really on the first statement on the slide from our hairstylist, hair has a lot to do with our health. So probably the question that you want to ask, follow up to that, is how? Well, let's go through this exercise. Which product on the screen currently has the most hazardous chemicals? So I'll give you all a second to look at the various different products and then think about it and go ahead and put one, two, or three in the chat. So before I reveal the answer, I want you to consider a few things on the next slide. The total number of chemicals in the products that you use is not the same as the number of ingredients listed on the bottle. Number two, some of the chemicals with the highest health hazards, like phthalates and parabens, are known endocrine disrupting chemicals. Both Tia, Bing have said this term already as well. We'll learn what those are in a few slides. And then lastly, each of these products have an F word in common. It may not be the one that you're thinking of up top, but we'll talk briefly about what that F word is as well. All right, so I think you've had a few seconds. Okay, so we have 3, 1. Thank you for those that are participating in the chat. Okay, so let's see who is correct. So unfortunately, the reality is the children's product Just For Me contains more hazardous chemicals, with 24 of the 196 chemicals in this particular product versus the 29 that's actually listed on the bottle. And these chemicals have been linked, some of them have been linked to chronic health concerns, including cancer. So in other words, the product that you use to clean your tub has less harmful chemicals than the product you use on your child's hair. Mm. So is the right answer. Let's sit with that for a second, right? So let's sit with that. And all of this information, of course, is coming from the Breast Cancer Prevention Partners, the Right to Know Act. Backwards. So what are endocrine disrupting chemicals? We've said this word a few times. So I'm going to use EDCs for short for the remainder of this conversation. And before I do that, you'll notice at the bottom of the slide that 71% of the chemicals linked to chronic health effects in this particular product, and a lot in the two products as well, are because of fragrance. And fragrance is our F word for the day, for those that were paying attention. And fragrance can mean dozens to hundreds of chemicals that you would never see listed on the bottle. So that's why you have 29 chemicals or ingredients listed on this particular bottle, but over 196 chemicals are actually contained in this one product. So what are EDCs, or endocrine disrupting chemicals? So EDCs are chemicals that interfere with the body's endocrine system. It's our endocrine system is made up of glands and organs that produce, store, and secrete hormones. So in other words, these chemicals interfere with the way our body's hormones may work. They are found in several different places in our environment. They are ubiquitous, in other words, and some of those places are in our personal care products, and they can affect your health, including your risk for cancer. And for the remainder of this conversation, what I'm going to do is connect EDCs to breast cancer risk, and I'll be sharing some of the research from this topic. So I oftentimes want to use this as an opportunity to also pause and to remember those among us that have been survivors, overcomers, as Tia would know, of breast cancer, because they are the individuals that we are working on behalf of, in addition to our communities as a whole. So if you are an overcomer like Tia, if you know of other individuals in our communities that are surviving the disease or have passed away, unfortunately, because of this disease, and you want to remember them at this time, I do want to hold space for us to do that before I give you the numbers, because we have to remember that the statistics, the numbers, et cetera, are people, and those individuals are members of our community. So I want to hold space now to remember those still with us and those that we have lost. All right, thank you. So we've heard some of these statistics already. And again, these numbers are people, right? So we know that one in eight women will be diagnosed in their lifetime. Thank you, Bing Ashe. And I notice here we're having some conversations in the chat as well, that we look at our ingredients, which is perfect. We're going to be able to give you guys additional tools to support your efforts at the end as well. So these are just some reminders about the statistics, just the reminders that 5 to 10% of breast cancer cases are hereditary. This is a very complex disease. We know a little bit of a lot, but we also don't know a lot about a little bit. So over 40% of Black women specifically are more likely to die from the disease. Black women are more likely to get triple negative breast cancer. Tia has shared her testimony in terms of being a statistic and how she's also overcome those statistics to really serve in the space as well. So all of these are examples of disparities, differences between population groups. And what I'm going to do in the next few slides, again, 5 to 10%. So if you're looking at 100% of the pie, 5 to 10% means that you have over 80%, 75 to 80% of information that we're still trying to figure out. So this conversation is just one piece of that puzzle. Can personal care products contribute to our risk factors for breast cancer? So let's continue the conversation with what we know, utilizing two disciplines, epidemiology as well as basic science. So from the epidemiologic perspective, which is the science of public health, we know that Black women carry the burden of EDC exposures or endocrine disrupting chemicals found in hair and other personal care products. We use these products prior to the age of 13. Hair oils and relaxers have been associated with early menarche, which is a breast cancer risk factor. And hair dyes, for instance, have been associated with the 45 to 51% increased risk for breast cancer. And I'll provide some additional context in the next few slides. So we also know from the bench science perspective that parabens, which are known endocrine disrupting chemicals, so parabens are preservatives that are found in many of our care products, personal care, as well as other products. We know that parabens specifically have been found to be at higher concentrations in urine samples of Black women compared to that of white women. And these chemicals have been shown to increase cell growth. They have been shown to decrease cell death and alter gene expression of breast cancer cell lines. So in the words of Jan Robinson Flint, who is the founder of Black Women for Wellness and Elevate's organization out here, she often says that Black women are overexposed and underprotected when it comes to personal care product exposures from EDCs. I'm highlighting two body of work from one of my mentors, Dr. Adena Yanos. One, also just wanted to preface this to say, individuals in this space, while there may not be many of us that look like me, there are some of us that look like me and you that are working at finding some of the questions related to disparities pertaining to personal care product exposures and breast cancer risk. And this is just one individual. So this is some of her work. So I mean, I'm not going to go into these in full detail, but I do want to preface to say that some of the research around this space, specifically around Dr. Yano's work, has found that dark hair dyes, for instance, have been associated with 51% increased risk of breast cancer for Black women. The use of these shades and the higher frequency of use has been associated with ER-positive disease, which is a subtype of breast cancer. Tia mentioned the different subtypes during her presentation. And then lastly, the use of permanent hair dyes greater than 10 years, or whether you use a home kit or go to a salon, all of these various different factors has been shown to increase the odds of a higher tumor grade by twofold. So when I say tumor grade, that essentially describes how normal or abnormal cancer cells look under a microscope. And what this particular statement is saying that we see twofold increase imagery of tumors under the microscope when individuals have used darker hair dyes or used it from a home or a salon. So the more, keep in mind that the more normal the cells look, the less aggressive the cancer is, the more it slowly grows. And so these are kind of increased factors as well. So Patricia, anyone looked at issues associated with skin lightening cream? Yes, absolutely. And that is work that has been supported by, in this space, by Dr. Amy Zoda. And I can send you some information related to how you can learn more about that as well. I won't be covering skin lightening creams as a part of this particular presentation, but I can give you guys resources. So in the same fold, relaxer use. So this is probably the hot topic for many Black women, even as we are now moving towards more of a natural beauty, et cetera, relaxer use is also still a hot topic and a factor as well. And again, if you look at the bubbles on the screen, so just high level information, we see that the greater number of years that you use it, the frequency of use, being a former user or current user, the length of months and years that you've used the product, et cetera, all of these have been shown to increase your risk for the disease, ranging from 18 to 72% increased risk. So I'm gonna take us through another exercise. So go ahead and use the chat for me as we bring this to a close. Can cigarette smoking increase your risk for lung cancer? Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Are the chemicals in my hair products increasing my risk for breast cancer? Now, I want you to think about this for a second as you're providing a response in the chat. If you hesitated to answer yes, or if you hesitated to say no, or if you hesitated to say maybe, did you have the same hesitation when I asked the first question about does smoking increase lung cancer? So the reality is this conversation is not a part of our natural vernacular. For some of us, it is. So Abigail Lopez, who is a research manager that works with me, she's been entrenched in this conversation for a while. So for her, it may be automatic. But for those of you that are learning this information for the first time, you may be, I need more information, et cetera. So I bring these two questions back and forth because while it's been a little over 80 years where we now can be automatic that if you smoke, the likelihood of you getting lung cancer is substantially higher. We are not there yet in terms of the literature where we can say, if you use a particular hair product, this is what is going to happen and this is how it's related to your health. We're not there yet. The research is still evolving. However, with the research that we have, we do have resources to help support individuals that want to reduce their exposure risk, right? So it may not be automatic for American Cancer Society, for example, to say that you need to do this. It may not be automatic for some of us to say, yes, this is a factor. But for those, again, using the information that I've shared and others that you can look for yourself, there are ways for you to reduce your exposure to these chemicals. Again, this is just one piece of the puzzle in terms of increasing your risk factor. So this is also aspects where you can reduce your exposure. Looking at, again, the 100% of the pie, 5 to 10% is hereditary. The other 80% is what we're focusing on for this conversation. And this is one aspect of that 80%. So here are some resources. If I've piqued your attention, and if you want to learn more about this topic area, the top row is for you. These are, you can feel free to take a screenshot, and I'm also going to give you a website where you can access this information as well. So information related to exposures, information, a documentary that you can watch, et cetera, that is the top row. If you are interested in using applications or Google Chrome extensions that will give you information about the types of chemicals that you are being exposed to in your personal care products and other products that you use on a daily basis, the bottom row is for you. I'm going to highlight two of those particular resources in the next two slides and then bring it to a close. And I don't mind staying for a few to answer questions as well. And I'll give you my email address for those that are interested in learning more. So the Non-Toxic Black Beauty Project is probably one of the my most favorite projects to be a part of. Tia and I are a part of the advisory board, which includes other researchers in the space. Dr. Janos is one of those. Dr. Zoda is another, several different researchers in the beauty justice space. And this is a database that includes over 700 beauty products across 80 brands that are sold by Black-owned companies. And these products have been vetted to have that do not have chemicals, toxic chemicals that have been linked to health concerns, disproportionately impacting the Black community, specifically Black women. So these are 10, it has 10 product categories, and you can go onto the website today. And if you are interested, you can purchase products owned by Black businesses to support your journey to reducing your exposure to EDCs and personal care products. Clearia is co-founded by Amy Rosna, who is such an amazing person. And this is a Google Chrome extension as well as an app that will flag chemicals of concern in your cart before you make a purchase. So now it's up to you. So if you go to Amazon, if you go to Sephora and you want to purchase whatever you want to purchase, this particular Google Chrome application or app will flag all of the ingredients of concern and give you the resources to share with you about why it's a concern. So if you want to look at a live demo, you can feel free to visit our website and our YouTube channel for how to use this particular. Boy, we went all the way back. So that is it for me. And again, if you have any questions about the projects that we just went over, feel free to email me as well. And I just want to reiterate a lot of some of the statements that Tia denoted in her presentation. Know your normal, get screened, know your family history, et cetera. So 5 to 10% is hereditary, but there are other factors that we have to be aware of as well. And share this information with others that may not know it. So thank you so much for having us, and I'll turn it back to Dr. Murray.
Okay, thank you very much. This was very good. I really like several things. The clarity in which you guys presented the information, the realness of it. Like, you know, this is not some sort of esoteric thing. This is about our health and our, especially the health of our Black women. And also the research and evidence that you guys presented, it was really good. Do you all do this often? Yes?
So as a part of the Bench to Community initiative, we do have an education arm. Okay. And all of the community advisory board members, as well as myself and Dr. Lindsay Trevino, our postdoctoral fellow, Jasma Tapia. We do several of these presentations throughout the community here in Southern California. And then Tia is like her own amazing shop by herself, and she breaks it. So the beauty of doing CBPR is that I don't have to be an expert in any, in everything. And she's a phenomenal trainer and breast health educator. So it's just like, hey, Tia, like, do what you do best. And she always does. And Bing and I have been on this journey, like you said, for the past 10 years. So he always brings that level of just grounding, and from the Black male perspective as well, because oftentimes we're only talking about the Black woman experience. And it's like, no, listen, like, there's a brother that's been doing this work on your behalf, and then we're going to be transitioning into focusing on Black men as well. So yeah, so this is our crew. So it's usually one of us from, or two or three of us from the research team, but it's always a community advisory board member and a researcher that's tag teaming these presentations. Nice. At least that's the goal.
That's very nice. So I definitely will be talking with you guys so that this will not be the last presentation on Environmental Fridays that you, your team, and others associated with what you do. One of the surprises for me, I maybe missed it in some of your bios or something, or website, Loma Linda University?
Oh, yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. When did I start? So I started my doctorate online in 2012. So my dissertation actually focused on, my dissertation and my master's work focus is on health disparities from a cultural and also religiosity and spiritual context. So I use the Adventist health study specifically for my dissertation, looking at perceptions of discrimination and hypertension and the role of religious coping and moderating that relationship. So Dr. Susanna Montgomery, it was a part of my dissertation committee, and I actually met her through Ms. Phyllis Clark. So I didn't know Dr. Montgomery at the time because I was in the School of Public Health and she was in behavioral health. And that's also how I met Bing and the rest of the Cost of Beauty team. So I've been in Southern California for about 10 years, and what brought me here was to finish my doctorate. So I started online and then moved out here about 10 years ago. But yeah, so I've been working with all of these people. Tia, I don't remember how we met, but social media. It's been a journey. I'm a member of Mount Rubidoux in Riverside.
Oh, okay, you're in Mount Rubidoux.
Yeah, yeah. So we're part and being. Feel free to chime in. I don't have to be the only one speaking, but that's how we connected. So he's a Morehouse College man. I'm a Morehouse School of Medicine graduate as well. So we didn't meet in Atlanta. We met in California as well. So
coincidentally, I was actually working on a prostate cancer study for African-American men. Mm. And what we were doing, we were going around the community doing health fairs, but we were also using it as opportunities to collect data for African-American men. And so when this project came about for women and breast cancer, they were like, we need someone that understands, academia, that understands some of the science, but also has a very strong connection with community. And so that's where they kind of threw me in. Okay. And so it was kind of interesting because here I am, a community person that's working in academia, and Dede was a academic working with a community-based organization. And I think it's just been a really dope marriage. Yep. Where you have community working. And, a lot of times there's always this schism, or there's always not always, but it can be conflict between, you know, academia and the community, especially in the African-American community. Mm-hmm. You know, we can suffer from, what is it, research fatigue, when you always have researchers come in and wanting to examine what's going on in the Black community. And then you also have an issue with academia taking the information from the community and not sharing it back. And one of the things that I think that I commend us on, even after we're no longer associated with Loma Linda University, we're always sharing these presentations. We're always giving it back to the community. Because in translational research, it takes years for stuff to get from the academy to the community. What is it, like 15 years or 18 years?
Yeah, it's like 17 years, but I'm pretty sure it's longer now. Because right. That research is like dated, but yeah.
Right. So we like developing
it's like developing a drug. That's sort of the timeline for developing a drug too.
Right.
Yeah. Gloria, you have comments, questions? I'm pretty sure you do.
Yeah. This has been really a good presentation in terms of information. But yeah. What I really like is the fact that you're going back and giving this information in a way that it can benefit the people who are the target of your research and your information collection. And as you spoke, I kept wondering, which you answered finally, is there a way for people to know what products they should try to stay away from or try to gravitate toward? Because ultimately, if we get a lot of information and we don't know how to benefit from it, you know, it's nice information, it's academic, it's good to know, but ultimately it's for our betterment. So I appreciated that very much.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to ask if anybody had questions that they want to ask verbally, I mean orally.
Arlene?
I have a comment, well, commendation for the presentation. It touched me on several levels, right? Personal, because I'm interested in anything to do with health and wellness. My family, my immediate family, 50% have been diagnosed or died from cancer, both breast and prostate cancer. And also on an academic level, I appreciate the genetic information and also the cell information. So you're doing an extraordinary work because your audience is very large. I also appreciate the resources that you provide because you've not only presented a problem, but you gave us something to do to solve, to help address that problem. So I screenshot the information and I will be checking out those sites. I do have a question. There was one slide with the three products, the baby product, the shampoo, and the other. And you mentioned something about the chemicals, the number of chemicals and the percentage of something. I missed that. Can you clarify, please?
Sure. Yeah, I can definitely put it back up. I normally take time. Sorry, I sped through that. Let me put it back on the screen. So that I'm a visual learner, so it usually helps me kind of walk people through it visually. So this again, so I can send you the full report, an executive summary of this particular report that I animated. And what they did was use, I believe it's liquid chromatography to examine the chemicals that were in these products and then look at linkages from the literature to specific health outcomes. And so all three of these products actually has diethylphthalate, for example, in each of them. And then what I denote for each of these products are the number of chemicals that have been linked to chronic health effects because of fragrance. And so this particular report is directly connected to a legislation that was passed in 2020 here in Southern California that is pushing manufacturers to be more transparent about what types of chemicals that are comprised in that one word, fragrance. So as I mentioned, fragrance can be several hundred, a few to several hundred different chemicals, and manufacturers do not have to let us know what is in that particular
So when we look at a label and we see all these, we see it may appear to have less chemicals, but fragrance could mean
a number of things. Tons
of chemicals.
Exactly. Okay. So when you look at this one product, and so this is something that I actually did, because I was thinking about, okay, how do I present this to people in a way where it'll bring the message home, right? So I bought each of these products and I counted the number of ingredients that were listed. So when I counted the ingredients, it was only 29 listed on the actual bottle itself. But when you go back to this report, it's actually over 196 chemicals that are contained in this one product.
Okay.
So that's why I try to kind of tell people, it's just like, you know, just because it says one number on the bottle itself, that does not mean that's the total number list of chemicals that are contained in that one product. And out of 196 chemicals, 24 of those have been linked to chronic health concerns. The other two, I'll pull it up in just a second. So when you compare it, so Kaboom, for instance, has, let me pull that up. Sorry, go ahead. I'll let you, you had a follow-up.
Would you say that we should just avoid anything that has fragrance, the label fragrance on it? Since we don't know what it is.
Right. So I try not to kind of give...
Generalizations,
because this space is so deeply personal to a lot of people. When I started this project, I actually had a knee-jerk reaction. So I have a bachelor's in biology, and when this project came to me, I was annoyed. I was annoyed because as a Black woman that I used to perm my hair all the time because it helped me manage it better. And as a Black woman that was trying to go natural, and I cut my hair three times trying to go natural because it was hard, I was just annoyed that there was another thing that I had to think about. Mm-hmm. And I was not alone in my annoyance. So this has been a journey for me as well. And I can relate to our community in terms of this particular space. So I try not to give, no, don't use this. Yes, do this.
Okay.
But what I am going to tell you is, depending on your personal journey with your hair, yourself, and your health, utilize the resources that we're providing and make an informed educational decision about your health.
Okay.
Thank you. Tia, yes. I saw you kind of, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
No, I was going to say, I completely agree, you know, because it is tough. And we want to try to meet people where they are, but then give them the tools and the resources for them to continue to do the research and be able to make informed decisions. And that's why we always talk about going from awareness to action. We want to be able to move people to take action. And we know that this, you know, some of this can be expensive. I will say, when I was diagnosed with breast cancer, I got rid of everything. I chucked every single thing, from hair care products, skincare products, cleaning solutions, you know, laundry detergent, soap powder, you name it, I got rid of it. And I started to do DIYs, things that I knew exactly what was in my products. And then, of course, that became, for me, with my schedule getting busy, I started to, now let me find the products that are on the shelves that are a little bit more safer that I can use in my home. But that can be pricey and expensive for people. So we say, you know, start somewhere. And eventually, as you start, you know, if the bottle is full, it's brand new, you know, we would love for you to, you know, switch over to something clean. But I always tell people, once that bottle empties out, then replace it with something that's clean. Don't go back to using those same products and you know, keep re-exposing yourselves. Our overall goal is, again, fight cancer, don't feed it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that.
Absolutely. And Jessica is agreeing. She's like, any little bit helps, which is absolutely, that is the gospel that we're sharing with people. Any little, literally any little bit helps. And I'm a testament of that. after the annoyance, I took action, right? Because it's hard to learn all of this information and not, for me, it was hard to learn this information and not do something about it. Mm-hmm. And I'll be very honest with you, like my personal health in terms of just my reproductive, you know, with my menstrual cycle has significantly lessened with pain as a result of me reducing not just chemical toxins for my life, but also changing my food, changing the way that I show up in terms of exercising and moving my body. So I went, you know, I'll give my personal examples and my story. If you relate to it, great, but you have to really kind of walk this journey. That's going to be beneficial for you because my story may not necessarily be yours.
Okay. Well, one of the things that I'm thinking about, I'm an editor for Benton Spirit, a community, a local community newspaper, but we are online and everything too. Is there a way that we could work with you? And I see Jessica putting a lot of information in to maybe have a monthly article. We are bi-weekly. And I don't want it to make it like, you know, lots of work for anyone, but maybe a monthly column or something that we could put into our newspaper, even though it's local. Again, it's online, it's on Facebook, it's so people all over the world really could access it. Is that something that maybe we could talk offline about?
Yeah. Abigail, you've been in contact with Abigail and she
okay.
Yeah, so I as a newly minted tenure track professor, I'm learning not to say yes or no right away.
Oh, I know. I hear you.
So Abigail
might be
So Abigail, I don't know if she's able to come online, but this is just a phenomenal human that God has blessed me with to help me with research engagement aspect of this work, because it is a lot of work. So we don't say yes or no right away, but we are than willing to work with you to get more of the word out. And we have a ton of resources on our website as well. And Jessica, if you want to reach out to, I'm going to put Abigail's email in the chat. And just let us know how we can support your efforts. We're more than happy to do so.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, because I was thinking all along in your presentations is, okay, you do this work. It's community engagement. It's a really great example of community engagement between a university, local nonprofits, and the community. It's really great. Are you guys thinking of like taking this to other communities? Because I know people who would want to jump on this.
Yeah. We're open, right? So I often say we're willing to share the gospel of menstrual community however wide it wants to go. So I think for us, our dynamic works well because all of us are deeply committed to this work. Mm. And we're willing to share with whoever wants to listen. And again, not just to share the information in a way that's going over people's head, but to really bring you as a part of the conversation, because this is, I see these as conversations. So Bench to Community specifically has a platform called Salon Conversations that we host. And all of these, it's so similar to Environmental Fridays. Mm-hmm. And we host these spaces for community members. We bring in researchers, we bring in people in the policy legislative space. We bring folks that are willing to, you know, share their work and information and wealth of knowledge with community folks. And we house it on our YouTube channels so that you can go back and learn more about the space. So there are variations of this presentation as well that you can find online. So if I went over something too quickly or you missed something, we also have space as a part of YouTube that's under our Salon Conversations umbrella that you can visit. And then on a biannual basis now, we have a Bench to Community Symposium that we bring folks together in the same format as well. It's a bit of a longer iteration of salon conversations, but we're working kind of some kinks out. Mm-hmm. Because it was very popular during the pandemic, but people are Zoomed out. So trying to figure out ways to re-engage in people in that space as well.
Okay. Anybody else has questions? I still have more questions.
I do. I don't want to manipulate it too much, but I do have another question. Okay. In the your survey that you did, I don't know. I was wondering if you saw any correlation between age and the embracing of the chemical, rejection of the chemicals and specifically relaxers. How a woman, you know, how did they relate to that? Was there any, did you see any correlation with age and the acceptance or non-acceptance of the harmfulness of the chemicals that are in relaxers?
That's actually a really great question. I haven't done that analysis. Yeah.
Okay. I was curious. I asked because I think I get the sense that the younger generation are more inclined to stay away from those chemicals, but older generation, not so much. That's just the sense that I have. I have nothing to support it, but from what I've seen visually.
I'm just curious. So Bing mentioned that we created a tool, and so it's a scale that we looked at perceptions of hair and identity, and then we also looked at perceived risk. So it's two subscales in one. It's 11 item scale, and what I could do is I can cross tab that with our age categories to see if there's any significance in terms of being associated. So we can use those questions to kind of get a little bit of a sense. Mm-hmm. So that was what came to mind up top of head to see if I don't know, because I don't think anybody's ever asked that before.
I look at my classroom. Yeah. I've been here a while, and I remember when most of the African American or Black females had relaxers, and over time, I'm not seeing that.
Maybe I just wondered here. Because I came to the U.S. in the 60s, mid-60s, to do university. And one of the things that I learned is how important it was for Black women to have their hair looking straight all the time. I was even told that there were some women that their husband never saw their natural hair. And for me, that was strange, because coming from the Caribbean, it's something you do at some stage in your life, and maybe sometimes. And I actually ran into trouble culturally with Black Americans, because when I was coming, I got my hair permanently straightened. And so for me, hair was no big thing. It's my hair. And I saw girls washing their hair in the laundry room. And so it never occurred to me whether it was Black or white girls, just girls. And I did it. And then the word got back to me. Who do I think I am exposing my hair before these white girls? And I thought, well, they weren't seeing it go back to its natural state. So what was the issue? And as I lived in the US, I learned more and more how important hair is and the appearance of hair. And even I'd see little children with their hair straightened. And for me, that was strange. Of course, later on, you know, that trend went internationally. But I also lived in to see when you had to have an afro or else you were not Black. And I thought, okay. And then of course nowadays it's up to you. So, and as was said just now, more and more younger people, of course they have more options, and more younger people are going away from actually having their hair, their natural hair straightened, but it's still being done. And I think the awareness of the concerns that we should have of putting using these chemicals is very important. And it's, besides being aware of style and appearance, it's a more significant reason to make these choices.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah.
Yes. All right. So
I have to jump off in 2 minutes for another call, but I just wanted to, so from some of our qualitative work, so in Bing's slide, it says cancer, everything causes cancer. That particular statement actually came from some of our young people they were very passionate about, again, like I said earlier, like I had an irritation at first to this conversation because it's like, what else, being a Black woman in America, hello. What else do you want me to avoid or talk about, et cetera? So there was kind of that knee-jerk reaction from several of our participants. And if I remember correctly, a lot of our young women were the ones that had more choice words to say than some of our older folks when we were interviewing. And I know from Bing's perspective, when he spoke to the men, it was something else as well.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm glad that you're including the men too, because men do get breast cancer, maybe not as much as women do to that extent. But I think, and I heard you say that you're going to do research also that involves the men, which is good.
Yeah, Bing has been on me about
that. Okay.
The original project only focused on Black men's perspectives. We didn't, even though they still talked about themselves and their hair journey, which was really interesting.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And one thing I was going to say, we have to think about, even, you know, with LGBTQ plus community, we're starting to see a slight rise in diagnosis, especially with all the products that are being used and some of the hormones that are being used. And those are, you know, that's something we're not thinking about. So we're starting to have more conversation around this, this topic. So, you know, everything we talked about today, like I said, it is a health crisis, especially in the Black community.
That's a great suggestion for a topic.
I have a speaker for you if you're interested in.
I'm always interested.
I'll share. So let me send you the YouTube video because We Act for Environmental Justice, which is a nonprofit organization out of New York.
Okay.
They just had a publication come out looking at them identifying individuals. So kind of including information related to the LGBTIQI+ community.
Okay.
So let me share that with you. I can email it to you.
Yes. That would be
great. They're working with another folks out here in California to bring more of that information and messaging out to the forefront as well, because they're oftentimes the forgotten community within the Black context that we don't talk about or invite them to the table. So,
yeah.
I mean, even down to breast health, you know, we're not having those conversations with young girls. We talk about puberty and menstrual cycle, but we don't talk about breast health and the things that are impacting us as we get older.
Right.
I think, Tia's presentations are phenomenal, and it doesn't have to be during Breast Cancer Awareness Month. But I think it's really important for us. She has a calling for this, and she's a phenomenal speaker, but not just for adults, but also for young people. And where is Andrews again?
Springs, Michigan.
Okay, never mind. Y'all not a close. She's in Atlanta.
That's okay. We can make something happen.
Exactly. So in terms of like the work that she's doing with just the breast health education piece, it's digestible. And our young people really do need to be more involved.
Right.
I apologize. I have to go.
So yeah, we are trying to close off here too. So I want to thank all of you, all three of you, for a very good presentation. And I'd like to thank my co-host and to all of the other participants We will continue this type of conversation in upcoming Environmental Fridays and other ways that we could work together. And so we want to thank you so very much for the information, the passion that you show in with this important work. Thank you very much. Have a great weekend. I believe this is Easter weekend. Happy Easter, everyone.
Yes. Take care. And thanks again to the co-presenters.
Bye-bye. All right.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.